The heart and soul of this course are its projects. I can't really teach you design. You have to learn it by doing it yourself. The best I can do is to introduce you to some specific techniques, such as modeling and technologies such as UML, that you can use in thinking about how to solve design problems. The learning experience comes from applying them to a problem and getting a feel for how they work. A course on software design faces an important challenge. Interesting design typically occurs when confronting large, complex problems. But those can't be dealt with within the constraints of a single course. I have taken a different approach to structuring projects called design studies. The idea here comes from the world of building architecture, in which the architect often constructs a variety of small-scale models in order to explore a design space. For each of the projects in this course, I ask you to solve it several different ways and then to systematically study the differences. The projects themselves are relatively small, and although some coding is involved, you'll be working on teams with enough members that you should have enough resources to get the job done and then study the variations. I have also tried to make the project similar to those in the real world. The first similarity is that you will be working with team members that you are not co-located with. You will have to learn to quickly organize yourself to work in a parallel, distributed fashion. The second similarity is that the projects are somewhat open-ended. That is, although there are basic requirements, there is room for you to be creative in your solutions and to go beyond those requirements if you believe you can significantly add value to the product you are producing. Of course, the danger with an open-ended project is you might get engaged in polishing an extension and not have a working solution to the basic problem. I strongly suggest that you tackle these projects in an incremental manner. That is, begin by producing a trivial working program providing only minimal functionality, then add one new feature at a time, ensuring that the older functionality still works. The third similarity to the real world is that the projects are phased. What this means is that the three projects all deal with the same problem domain, and each subsequent project builds on the solutions developed in the previous ones. In fact, you are specifically encouraged to make use of code from your own or other teams that was developed earlier. This situation is typical of the real world, where successful projects often have long lifetimes in which the additional features are added and released to customers. The fourth similarity is that the members of your project team change for each phase. In the real world, turnover of teams is common, and you have to learn to work with a variety of people. One specific benefit is that by having team members from different teams, you will have familiarity with and access to a variety of working solutions from which you can choose components from previous phases. Moreover, managing teams in this fashion provides a motivation for designing your solutions in a way that they can be reused on future projects, even if you don't know exactly what those projects are.